everyone. The first song that we're going to sing is Redeemed. And that's 337. There's two versions, but the one on 337 is the one we'll be singing today. My faith looks up to thee. It's a fairly new one to me, so thank you for supporting me here.
Darkness turned to day, with sorrow stayed away.
We can all turn now to 672. That is Spirit of the Living God.
Father in heaven, this is the day that you have made, and we rejoice, and we're glad in it. And we're in such a beautiful place that you have brought us to here in Ojai, and on this day to worship you. Be with us, inspire us, minister to us. May we know that we have been with Jesus today. I pray in his name. Amen.
Amen.
So the opening song today is 518. Standing on the promises. I think we all can attest to God's faithfulness, right?
Standing on the promises of God, the King, through eternal ages, let His praises sing. Glory in the highest, I will stand and sing. Standing on the promises of God.
Morning again, everyone. Beautiful Sabbath day. We're few, but we're mighty in Christ. So let's worship the Lord today. John 1:1-3 or 4 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. And without him, nothing was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men." What a blessing. What a blessing to know the Lord. And today, I welcome you all, members and visitors. We have many people gone for various reasons. I'll all legitimate, I think, but that does happen sometimes. But you know, it says where two or three are gathered with the Lord, He is there. He's there with us, even individually. We want to welcome Alan Reinick. And Alan, I hope you will tell him a little bit about where you come from and what you do. I know you're going to tell him what you do, but tell him a little bit about yourself too, please. I think most of us know Alan. We've seen him many times, and he's always been a blessing to us in the work that he does. So may God bless us as we pursue the Lord today.
Good morning, church family. Friends, visitors, welcome. Today's scripture reading is found in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. Under the subheading of "I never knew you." Not everyone who says to me, "Lord, Lord," shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, "Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?" And then I will declare to them, "I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Good morning, Ojai Church. Happy Sabbath. Well, Galen, you know, this is the first time somebody's asked me to give my own, bio or introduction. But hey, we're all family here, right? I like this church because it's very family-oriented, and really enjoyed hearing the prayers and the praises. So I've had the privilege, for those of you who don't know me, of serving the Adventist Church here as the Director of Public Affairs and Religious Liberty for just over 3 decades. They haven't been able to get rid of me, and I haven't screwed up yet, at least not bad enough. And so my day job is largely representing individuals who lose their jobs because of their faith. And, you know, we started out mainly doing cases for our own church members, helping them with Sabbath workplace conflicts and all. And what happens when you get good at something is the world beats a path to your door, and we've been expanding. And representing people of many, many different faith traditions. And most recently, of course, we had, I would call it a bubble, because there were thousands of Americans who lost their jobs because they chose within their own faith tradition to trust God rather than the vaccine. And many people lost their jobs. And whatever, you know, we may think of someone's theology, our role is to protect religious freedom. So, you know, the Adventist Church has been very strongly supportive of public health, of vaccines. We're very interested in health, vegetarian diet, healthful living, and all of that. But we're also very committed to protecting the rights of conscience. And so that's what we've been doing. And it's been quite a journey. And I'm very thankful that as of July 1st, we have a new addition to our ministry sitting right here with us in the pew, your very own Naomi Ishu. So good to see you, Naomi. And we're very, very thankful to have her. So I guess this is kind of a religious liberty sermon in a way, but let me just offer a prayer before we get started. Father in heaven, we need your wisdom, we need your inspiration, we need to hear from you, not just my thoughts and my words. And I pray we're all coming here from different experiences and And some different cultures too. And I just pray that you would minister to each one of us and help us to grasp the reality of who you are and what you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So, I decided not to do PowerPoint today because PowerPoint can kind of put you in a box. And I'm kind of reordering some scriptures. The Lord's given me some new insights into things that I've been preaching about. And so let's just kind of see how this goes. It's a familiar title for me, Finding Jesus in an Age of Counterfeits. Finding Jesus, the real Jesus, in an age of counterfeits. Now, the notion that this is an age of counterfeits, Jesus kind of bookends both the beginning and the ending of his ministry by talking about the counterfeits. Now, we're going to start with the dominant sermon at the end of his ministry in Matthew 24 and 25, and then we're going to go back. What our scripture reading was taken from was the Sermon on the Mount, and that was really where he began his public ministry. That was his most prominent early sermon, right, was the Sermon on the Mount. So the scene, they're on the Mount of Olives. He's with the disciples. He's just predicted the destruction of the temple. Anybody here ever been on the Mount of Olives overlooking the old city? I see a few hands going up. And now, these days, what do you see prominently? You see the Mosque of Omar, right? Gleaming in the sunshine. Well, back then, it was the Jewish temple. And that was literally the center of the universe, right? That was the center of their worship. Without it, they would be completely bereft. They wouldn't know what... I mean, to them, when they're asking Jesus, well, when will these things be and what will be the sign of thy coming in the end of the age, the destruction of the temple to them was kind of the end. You know, they didn't know what would come after that. So in his sermon, of course, Jesus sort of crunches saying things that apply both in his own time and throughout history and especially towards his return and the end of the age. But three times he warns about counterfeits, and he starts his answer, "See that no one leads you astray. Take heed that no one deceive you. Why? For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Messiah, and they will lead many astray." So I need your participation here. In our lifetime, who has come saying they're the Messiah? We've had a few. Come on. You're awake, at least as awake as I am. David Koresh is one. Jim Jones. You remember Jim Jones? I was at a Filipino church. There's a Filipino guy by the name of Kibaloy, I think his name is, who claims to be the Messiah. And then, of course, who's the Korean fellow? Sun Myung Moon, right? my family had some run-ins with the Moonies, as they were called back in the day. I don't know if we still call them that. And in fact, I had a stepbrother who, well, I think he got out kind of on his own, but I had a cousin who was kidnapped and deprogrammed. That's what they would do back in the day. Highly illegal, but, you know, family wanted to get their kid back, and that's what they did. We've had our share of false messiahs in our day. Jesus warned us that many would come, not in the name of some other religion. It's not warning about other religions, competing religions, not warning about Hinduism or Buddhism or Islam or, you know, any other ism. He's warning about counterfeits that are Christian, right? Christian counterfeits in the name of Christ. And then he talks about all the external signs of chaos, right? You'll hear of wars, rumors of wars. famines, pestilences, earthquakes. We just went through this pandemic. Many thought this was a fulfillment of prophecy. This was one of those plagues and that Jesus prophesied in the last days. And who's to say? Maybe it was. But he says these are only the beginning of birth pains, right? This is not it yet. So then he returns to the theme of false prophets. Verse 11, many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. We're going to see this concept of lawlessness again in Matthew 7. Now, I dare say that as Gentile believers in the 21st century, in our culture, we think of law in terms of the rules. So lawlessness would mean those who are really careless about the rules. But in the context of first century Judaism, it was more than the rules. The word Torah included all of the teachings, all the wisdom of God, the wisdom of Scripture. It wasn't just about the rules. And to be without or apart from the Torah was to be untethered from Scripture. So it's not an either or. It's not that, well, they're following the rules, but they're untethered from Scripture. No, it's a little bit of both, right? So we have, according to Jesus, false prophets arising and leading to a spiritual condition within the Christian community that is untethered to Scripture and careless of the rules, of the law, of the moral teachings of God. And then again, one more time, he says, if anyone says to you, look, here's the Messiah, or there he is, don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders so as to lead astray, if possible, even the elect. Well, we Adventists, you know, we lack a sense of humor. See, when I was working in interfaith circles, I'd hear that, like the Methodists or the Presbyterians, they would tell the jokes about, you know, somebody getting a tour of heaven and over there are the Methodists, shh, they think they're the only ones, right? And but the Methodists would tell that joke on themselves. I'm not sure that we Adventists are willing to tell that joke on ourselves, right? You know, that sometimes we think, oh, well, we're so great, we're the elect. Which simply means that we ourselves are also vulnerable to deception, right? Nobody is immune. We all need to keep a humble attitude and keep tethered to Scripture, right? So three times in the part of his, this is Jesus' apocalyptic sermon, Matthew 24 and 25, and we're going to wind up before we're done this morning in Matthew 20, and at the end of the sermon in Matthew 25, but three times Jesus emphasizes deception in the last days, false Christ, false prophets, an age of counterfeits. So how do we find the real Jesus? That's the question, because we know that there's going to be counterfeits. Now, if we turn back to chapter 7, let's see if I can do this. Just before the passage that we read for our scripture, Jesus says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. And he goes into how you can tell by their fruits. And then he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. What is the will of my Father who is in heaven? Well, in another place he says, my will is not that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God's will is an expression of his inclusive love for everyone and his desire to be reunited in a loving relationship with each and every one of us. That's his invitation to us, and an invitation that we can give to everyone. Because there's no one that God does not want to restore to a relationship with him, right? Is that right? Or is it that, you know, well, God wants the few and he rejects the many? There is a false gospel, by the way, that's very popular, that is very exclusive. We're going to talk a little more about that. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord. On what day? In the Greek, it's simply on the day. And to me, he's talking about Judgment Day. The day, as Paul writes, that we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now it's test time, folks. You're standing before the judgment seat of Christ. And let's say Peter is there and he's saying, now, all right, let's just make sure that you got your answer straight. You're going to be asked the question, why should we let you in to heaven? So let's practice. Somebody? Anybody? What are you going to say on that day? What is your answer? Why do you get to be in heaven? I'm going to wait. Okay, because of what Christ did for you? Okay, anybody else? Yes, sir.
Have mercy on me.
That's a good answer, too. Amen. I think of the Pharisee and the sinner praying, right? Anyone else? Well, in this passage, that's not what they say, is it? You've read it. You know what it says. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, do many mighty works in your name? They gave the wrong answer, didn't they? Wrong answer. It's not about how many people we gave steps to Christ. Good on you for giving out steps to Christ or glow tracks or witnessing or what, but that's not what earns you a place in the kingdom, is it? We do that because we love God and we know that God wants a relationship with all of us. We don't want anyone to be excluded. It's not all of the things we do or that we fail to do that earn us a spot in the kingdom or that exclude us from the kingdom.
It's relational.
And he says to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. We see that word lawlessness again. Now, if you think about it, here you have people who are Christian. In Christ's name, they are prophesying. They are engaging in spiritual warfare. They are casting out demons. They are doing mighty miracles. So they're doing these in the name of Jesus. They are Christian, at least in culture, in belief, in content, doctrine, in their practice. They're practicing a form of Christianity. And Jesus says, I don't know you, never did know you. We're not in a relationship. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. They are untethered to Scripture. They're not practicing the teachings of Scripture. Now, I would suggest to you that this passage describes the final apostasy. Jesus is talking about a Christian community in the approach to Judgment Day, right? On that day. What does the Christian community that's on the wrong road, what does it look like? Revelation 13, we are given a prophecy that the church is on the wrong road because it unites with the state and seeks to enforce religion by the power of the state, right? And it makes everyone worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed, to worship the image of the beast. And if you don't, you can't buy or sell. If you don't get the mark of the beast, you can't buy or sell, and you're subject to a death penalty. Now, there's parallels here. And one of the parallels we find is with respect to the word dunamis, the counterfeiting of the Holy Spirit. So the word dunamis here is the Greek word that's used where it says that they, when they say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not do many mighty works in your name? The miracles that they're doing, that they're practicing miracles, is the Greek word dunamis. Now, why do I say it's a counterfeit of the Holy Spirit? For that, we have to go back to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, taking us back to what we read in Mark 10 for Sabbath school. After the resurrection, the disciples know that something dramatic is about to happen. They think that Jesus is about to receive the kingdom. He's going to be enthroned as the king of Israel. And so what do they want? The same thing that they've always wanted. They want to rule and be in the right and the left hand, right? And so, what's the question that they ask? Acts 1, verse 6. Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? They're still thinking in political terms, in earthly terms. And Jesus says to them what? It's not for you to know the times, the seasons the Father has fixed by his own authority, the exousia, the authority to rule, to establish the kingdom. That belongs to the Father. And we as Adventists, we're reminded of the vision of Daniel 2, right? And Daniel 2, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream and he sees a succession of kingdoms. And then he sees a stone cut out without human hand, destroying all of the kingdoms of the earth and establishing a kingdom that will never be destroyed, right? And so we understand that when God establishes his kingdom, he does it. We don't do it without human hand. We have no part in it. He will do it in his own time by his own authority. Our part is different. Our part is share the love of Christ, to, you know, preach, etc., to live out the life of Christ as a witness. But we don't establish the kingdom. God establishes the kingdom. But So Jesus said to them, this is something the Father has fixed by his own authority. He has the exousia, the authority. But you are not going to receive the exousia. You will receive a different kind of power. And here is that word dunamis again, which is where we get English words like what? Dynamite, right? Dynamo, dynamic. The dunamis power you will receive when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So the dunamis, properly understood, is a reference to the Holy Spirit's power in our lives, which is the only power that God has ever promised to his church. He's never told us to seek political power. He specifically rejected that here when his disciples asked him about seeking political power. So if we look at Revelation 13 and we compare it with what we read in Matthew 7, we get a picture of an end-time apostasy with a church that is seeking political power, that has a counterfeit of the Holy Spirit, that is performing miracles and has prophets, is prophesying and engaging in spiritual warfare, and is untethered from Scripture. Lawlessness. This movement is actually a very powerful and fast-growing movement globally today. It is called the New Apostolic Reformation. And most of the pastors that I meet have never even heard of it. But it numbers hundreds and hundreds of millions of people globally. It is a movement that boasts hundreds, maybe more than 1,000 apostles and tens of thousands of prophets. Now, we know that the prophets are dubious, but even as kind of Pentecostal as you might say that this movement is, the Pentecostal denominations reject it as being way beyond, because it really is completely untethered from Scripture. So let me give you a simple recent example of how they relate to Scripture. And this came, I happened to be on an email list. I had a former client who was absolutely crazy. I would use a term that I probably shouldn't use in church, but she was batty. But she has decided that she's a prophet. I still get her emails. So apparently the bullet that allegedly grazed Trump's ear was at 6:11 p.m. And so they say, well, Ephesians 6:11 talks about putting on the whole armor of God. And so they make that connection to say that, the Holy Spirit protected Donald Trump and, make all kinds of assumptions based on that. And that's a form of numerology, really. It's not biblical interpretation according to any theological school of biblical interpretation. It's hocus pocus is what it is. And I don't say this as a partisan comment with respect to Donald Trump, okay? I just want to make that clear. And of course, those who want to say that God intervened to protect Donald Trump, they don't have an answer for those who actually got killed that day. Well, why Trump and not others? Did God not care about them? Maybe it's best not to attribute those events to God at all, right? At leave him out of it. My point is simply that we have a movement. The apostles are designated by themselves. They claim the authority of the Holy Spirit. And they claim to be, you know, because they have the Holy Spirit guiding them, they don't have to be tethered to Scripture. And they're not. And they claim absolute authority to govern the church. It's an authoritarian model of leadership because they say it is our role to command the spiritual warfare to establish the kingdom of God. And that essentially those who are not with us are demonic. And so they engage in very aggressive forms of spiritual warfare. The thousands of prophets here in the United States, they all predicted the last two presidential elections. And they insisted that God's choice was the same for both elections. And, you know, they had a 50-50 chance of getting it right, didn't they? And they did get it right the first time, but not the second time. And again, I'm not saying this as a partisan comment. I'm focused on the fact that whether you thought Trump was a good president or a bad president, whether you like him or hate him, let's leave God out of it. You know, the irony here, I've had this conversation with believers, you know, about how when Daniel speaks to Nebuchadnezzar, he says, you know, God sets up kings and he takes down kings, right? Well, if you ask them about the person that they voted for, yes, God set him up. If you ask him about the one that they didn't vote for, no, that wasn't God's doing. Well, either it's all God's doing or it's not. You can't pick and choose, right? It doesn't work that way. That's not being consistent and reasonable with how you handle the Word of God. You know, if you're going to attribute that God decided who was going to be president, then you got to do that for the one that you voted for and the one that you didn't vote for. So you have this global movement that does the four things that Jesus identifies in Matthew 7. What are those four things? They prophesy in his name. They cast out demons. They engage in spiritual warfare. They're doing many mighty miracles, which is the dunamis in the Greek. It's, you know, the abuse of the Holy Spirit. And lawlessness, untethered from Scripture. Those four characteristics describe this movement very, very clearly. But in terms of Revelation 13, we also see the abuse of the Holy Spirit. Because what do we see? We see fire being called down from heaven to earth on the sight of men to deceive those who dwell on the earth and to bring church and state together to enforce this counterfeit form of Christianity, right? Well, you know, Revelation borrows themes and stories from all throughout the Scripture. And there are two places where we see fire being coming down from heaven on earth in the Scripture, right? Where do we see that in Scripture? Well, the first place we see it is on Mount Carmel when Elijah is facing off with the prophets of Baal. And the question is, who is the true God? The true God is going to be the one who calls the fire down from heaven to earth. And in that story, it's not the false prophets of Baal, it's Elijah. And the fire comes down and consumes the altar, and it's a great moment of revival in Israel and turning back to the worship of God. Well, in Revelation 13, the fire comes down, as it were, to deceive. It's on the wrong side. Those of us who worship God, we're on the other side of, you know, the fire comes down to confirm the counterfeit. And that it's a counterfeit of the Holy Spirit, I think, is suggested by the experience of the disciples after Jesus' resurrection. Jesus promised to them the dunamis, the power of the Holy Spirit. And what do? They get together, and he said to wait for the promise of the Father, and so they pray, right? They get together for weeks until the festival of Shavuos, the Feast of Weeks, which we call Pentecost as Christians. And what happens? The Holy Spirit descends upon them like tongues of fire, the genuine Holy Spirit. So you have a genuine and you have a counterfeit. The counterfeit is very active in the world today, but so is the genuine. But you know, I think sometimes we look for a Holy Spirit to do something dramatic in our lives. When I was a brand new believer, did a little weekend retreat in the Redwoods. I was a student at Pacific Union College, and we went out and went camping, some of us out in Armstrong Redwoods out near Santa Rosa. And we prayed for the Holy Spirit, and we studied our Bibles, and we were hoping for some sort of ecstatic experience that never came. But what we realized was that by faith we had already received the Holy Spirit. We didn't need some sort of, you know, miraculous demonstration. The Holy Spirit was our promised gift to guide us day by day, to connect us to Jesus, that we could live a life of faithfulness to honor Him. We have all been given access to God through the Holy Spirit, haven't we? The gift is promised to us as believers. It's not something that we have to have some sort of miraculous outpouring. There may be a dramatic outpouring. It will be God's own time and by His own hand for His own purposes. So, how do we recognize and serve the real Jesus in an age of counterfeits? Well, Jesus spent the first third of His Sermon on the Mount, or His the sermon in Matthew 24 and 25, talking about conditions in the last days. But the last two-thirds He spent with a series of parables about what God's people would be like in the last days, and parables to guide us. I do a whole sermon on just, you know, going through those parables. We're not gonna inflict that, another whole sermon on you today. But I do wanna draw one parallel out of the final sermon, the judgment hour sermon, or parable, the parable of the judgment at the end of Matthew 25, where you see the king on his throne and they're separating the sheep and the goats. Because I think this points us to the character of Christ and how we can really follow Him and know that we're worshiping the real Jesus. So, Seventh-day Adventist Church has compiled a list of what we call 28 fundamental beliefs. I want to see a show of hands. Is there anybody here who could stand up and tell me what all 28 are?
No.
I can't, and I've been working for this church for a long time. Can you? You can do 24 of them? Okay. I'm not going to ask you to do it. But my point is, thankfully, that's not the test. Okay? That's not the test. Whether we get all of the doctrine exactly right. I think doctrine's important. I think doctrine teaches us a lot about who Jesus is. I think doctrine's very, very important. But that's not the test. So what's the test? Jesus says to those, you know, who are the ones who are the sheep who are going to be in the kingdom, who hear the words, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. You are the ones who, when I was thirsty, gave me a cup of cold water. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was an immigrant, you gave me shelter, you took me in." And the sheep, they say to him, "We did what? When? To you? We didn't know that. When did we do this to you, Jesus?" And you know the answer, right? "When you did it to the least of these." So I'm going to close. We had worship, we had week of prayer at the union office this week. We had a wonderful feast. And we were hearing stories about folks in the lineage of Jesus as reported in Matthew chapter 1. And I missed Monday, but the next three were talking about the ladies who were mentioned there. So you have Tamar, and you have Rahab, or Rahab first, and then Tamar, and then Ruth. You know who Ruth was? Ruth was a Moabitess. Do you know who the Moabites were? They were descendants of Lot, Abraham's nephew. You know, he narrowly escaped from Sodom and Gomorrah. His wife looked back, and he lost his wife. He escaped with his daughters, and he procreated as a result of incest. And that was the origin of the Moabites. Now, when Israel was coming north, out of after the 40 years that they were wandering in the desert after leaving Egypt, Moab refused to give them passage, refused to give them food or, to help them. They were inhospitable. And so there were prophecies about the destruction of Moab. Moab were enemies of Israel. In our politics today, there have been a lot of derision of certain kinds of countries, certain kinds of cultures. We had an immigration ban on folks from Arab nations, right, for a time. We have very harsh policies about immigration, and in Israel's day, Moab would have been on the list of banned countries. They were not friends of Israel, right? But somehow, Ruth's mother-in-law, she was connected to the faith. And so she followed her mother-in-law back to Israel, despite being told that, you know, this is not going to be a good life for you. And things haven't changed. If you are an unmarried immigrant woman coming to this country and you have no legal status, you're vulnerable. when Ruth went to glean in Boaz's fields, Boaz, who was very prominent, he had the best workers, but he had to tell his men, don't touch her, leave her alone. Why? She was vulnerable, and in that culture, she would have been fair game. She would have been subject to abuse, for sure. But Boaz was a gentleman. He was a godly man. And as you know the story, he took Ruth in and married her. And David was their grandson. And she's in the line of the Messiah. Someone who, at least in our culture, we would regard a foreigner, an unmarried immigrant without a woman, without any documentation, she would have been the least. How we treat the ones that we regard as the worst and the least is really a reflection of who we understand Jesus to be, isn't it? You know, if church is just a community for the saints, the ones who are like us, the ones that we can get along with, then it's not really church at all. Because Jesus makes room at the table for those that we'd rather not have at the table. But if we're going to follow and find the real Jesus, then it means that we're going to make room at the table for those that we might prefer to exclude. And who that is going to be different for each of us, because we all come from different backgrounds. You know, we have different biases. I come from a Jewish family. For me, you know, the kids protesting on college campuses with their anti-Semitic slogans and chanting, you know, from the Palestine, from the river to the sea, and calling for the extermination of the Jews, I don't want them at my table. I really don't. But you all are coming from a different place than I am, some of you. We all have our own biases, our own attitudes, our own whatever we've gotten from our cultural upbringing. Jesus isn't finished with us yet, is he? But if he's gonna be finished with us, we have to start by understanding who he really is. And his love knows no bounds, right? That's got to be front and center. We're going to disagree about how we understand biblical texts and biblical teachings. And, you know, Adventism has a fantastically developed theology, and I think it's marvelous. And it has been a blessing to me, you know, for many decades, for what? Let's see. Almost 50 years I've been in this church. I'm betraying my age now, David. But at the end of the day, you can believe all the right things and be lost. You know, those who said to Jesus, Lord, Lord, they were zealous for Jesus. They were doing it. And yet they didn't know him and he didn't know them. And I have confidence that that will not be us, that we will understand the love of God which surpasses knowledge, and that we will extend that love and grace to others. Help, my prayer for us is that we will learn to see Jesus in one another, that we will learn to see Jesus in others. You know, the sheep, they didn't realize that when they gave a cup of cold water to the thirsty, they were giving that to Jesus, right? But it's like, you know, the scene in The Wizard of Oz where they pull the curtain back and now they see that, you know, Oz is just an ordinary human being. Well, we've read the prophecy. We now know that the folks we want to exclude from the table are Jesus. So we don't have any excuses, do we? So let us take this knowledge of who Jesus really is and his love for everyone, his desire to include everybody. He's got a place at the table for everybody. Amen. And let's find and worship the real Jesus in an age of counterfeits. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you have given us glorious scriptures to show us who you really are. And I pray that you would bless us, that you would do a work in our hearts, that we would know you and love you and reflect that love in how we treat one another, in how we see one another. And that you would challenge us when we see people that we don't want to include at the table, that we would include them anyway, and that you would do that work in our hearts. Bless this Ojai Church, Lord. I'm so grateful for Pastor David. He's been a good friend to me for so many years, and I'm confident of his leadership here, and I'm confident of your love and your working in this congregation. I pray that it would be a light here in a pretty dark spiritual community. I just lift up this congregation before you and ask for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Real one.
what we know, not we are.
Amen.
Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon each and every one of us and grant us his Sabbath peace. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Arms unfair.